Welcome into the sanctuary of the City of Refuge Christian Church of Northwest Indiana. The Bible says in John 8:32 that you should know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. So get your Bible and follow along as Pastor Pirtle brings forth the words of life.
Well, praise the Lord, saints. Let's praise Him with another hand clap. Praise the Lord. All right. I want to thank God for preparing the way, because the sermon has already been preached. I mean, with the song, with the testimony, my message has already been delivered. Yes. So, Pastor put me up here. I said, okay, Pastor. I've been reading the book about the last generation of Christ, and that's what I'm going to speak on. But then when I got home, I heard God laugh. He said, no, I don't think you'll be preaching about the last generation. You're going to preach about the last days. I go, oh, my God, I know nothing about the last day. Lord, where do I start? And He said, start with your church's mission statement. So, Heavenly Father, I stand here. I empty myself so that you can use me as an empty vessel to work through me and from me to deliver this message that you have chosen, Lord, for your people to hear. So, our mission statement is to prepare the people of God like the five wise virgins for the return of Christ. And that's found in Matthew 25:4. Emphasis on, but the wise took their vessel with their lamps.
The Bible says in Matthew 24:42, watch therefore, for you do not know the hour your Lord is coming. I want you to know, church, that Jesus Christ could come this month, or He might come next week, or He could even come...
is what society calls the rapture of the church. Now, there are many commentaries regarding Jesus' return. There are various different opinions as to even if this is an event, how it will happen, when it will happen, or if it would even take place. There are so many commentaries described in the book of Revelations about the return of Christ. But since there are so many opinions and so many commentaries, I will be giving you many scriptures. Because it is not who's right, it's what's right. Okay. Although the word rapture does not appear in the Bible, there are different scriptures, such as John 14 and 3, where it says, we are received into the Lord. When everything is ready, I will come and get you so that you will always be with me. And also in 1 Thessalonians 4:16, for the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a commanding shout and with the voice of archangels and with the trumpet call of God. First, the believers who have died will rise in their graves. So that means that God is not just coming for us, he's also coming for his saints that died before his presence. We also, in these scriptures, the word caught up, received to God, is really in Greek terms, harpazo, which means caught up and plucked up, gathered together. This is how the rapture is going to take place. Examples of the rapture in the Bible also includes Genesis 5:24, for an example, regarding Enoch. And Enoch walked with God, and he was not because God took him. My quote was from the New Living Testament. Okay, another example is Elijah, 2 Kings 2 and 11. And it came to pass, is that 2 Kings 2:11? Yes, okay, well, I took the King James Version, I'm sorry. As they were walking along and talking, suddenly the chariots of fire appeared and drawn by horses of fire. It drove between the two men, separating them, and Elijah was carried up by a whirlpool into heaven. And the third example is Acts 1 and 9. After saying this, he was taken up into the cloud while they were watching, and they could no longer see him. Now, these are described as the rapture, but in Matthew's 25, 1 through 13, it's the parable of the 10 virgins. And in this scripture, God doesn't describe himself as taking the church as being raptured. God describes his return as coming back for his bride. He is the bridegroom. The bride is our church. In Matthew 25, 1 through 13, it reads, then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened unto 10 virgins, which took their lamps and went forth to meet the bridegroom. And 5 of them were wise and 5 were foolish. That they were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them. But the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps, 5, while the bridegroom tarried. They all slumbered and slept. And at midnight, there was a cry made, behold, the bridegroom cometh. Go ye and meet him. Then all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said unto the wise, give us your oil, for our lamps are gone out. But the wise said, answering to them, not so, lest there not be enough for us and you. Go ye rather to them that sell and buy for yourselves. So I stand here this morning, not giving you a sermon, but to give you a message. This message is regarding verse 4. But the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. So I will begin this message with the question. When Christ returns, will your vessel be filled with oil? In Matthew 24:3-14, later Jesus said on the Mount of Olives, his disciples came to him privately and said, "Tell us when this will happen. What signs will signal your return and the end of the world?" And Jesus said to them, "Don't let anyone mislead you. For many will come in my name, claiming I am the Messiah. They will deceive many. And you will hear of wars and rumors of wars and threats of wars, but don't panic. Yes, these things must take place, but the end won't follow immediately. Nations will go to war against nation and kingdoms against kingdom, and there will be famine and earthquakes in many parts of the world. But this is only the first of the birth pains, with more to come." And I just want to say that that is just signifying a woman who's given birth. You know, the pain comes before the delivery. "Then you will be arrested, persecuted, and killed. You will be hated all over the world because you are my followers. And many will turn away from me and betray and hate each other. And many false prophets will appear and will deceive many. Sin will be rampant everywhere, and the love of many will grow cold. But the ones who endure until the end will be saved. And the good news about the kingdom will be preached throughout the world so that the nations will hear it, and then the end will come." Now, Jesus speaks of all these signs of deception, wars, rumors of wars, nations against nations, famines, pestilence. And this is what the world is speaking of today. They are so focused on signs of the world. We already have COVID. We've already had earthquakes. We've had all these things. And this is what people are focused on today. But I want to point out to you in 2 Timothy 3:1-5, it speaks of the signs of today. "You should know this, Timothy, that in the last days there will be very difficult times. For people will only love themselves and their money." Sound familiar? "They will be boastful and proud." Sounds familiar? "Scoffing of God, disobedience to their parents, and ungrateful. They will consider nothing sacred. They will be unloving, unforgiving. They will slander others and have no self-control. They will be cruel and hate what is good. They will betray their friends, be reckless, be puffed up with pride and love pleasure rather than God." Now, saints, we see and hear of this today in magazines, in newspapers, on television, on Facebook, on Twitter. People are becoming scammed. They're being scammed. They're being hacked. They're being victims of identity theft. They're being religious without being righteous. We hear phrases like, "Oh, praise the Lord, saints. Oh, I'm blessed and I'm highly favored. Oh, I love you with the love of God." And when it gets to speaking about being unthankful and disobedient to parents, speaking for my own self, with this younger generation, they make me want to reach out and touch them. And I'm not referring to laying hands on, okay? let's get that straight. I do, however, pray for our teachers. I pray the armor of God over them because they are in a combat zone in the classroom without receiving combat pay. Now, not only will these signs continue to exist, but they will escalate as we approach the last days. In Matthew 24:33-35, Jesus says, these signs, in the same way, when you see all these signs, you can know his return is very near, right at the door. And I tell you the truth, this generation will not pass from this scene until all these things take place. Heaven and earth will disappear, but my word will never disappear. This generation is so focused on the signs and the times and the condition of the world, they fail to realize that of which the five wise virgins are referenced. Christ is more concerned about the condition of your heart than he is concerned with the condition of the world. So this is not a message about Christ's return as the bridegroom for his bride, or about his return as the King of Kings in the book of Revelations. It is a message for us to examine ourselves and our relationship with Christ. This is an examination to know if we are ready or not, as you saw in the video, that we are prepared for his return. 2 Corinthians 13:5-6 reads, examine yourselves to see if your faith is genuine. Test yourselves. Surely you know that Jesus Christ is among you. If not, you have failed the test of genuine faith. In this parable, just a minute. Okay. Oops, missed the page. Well, in this parable of the 10 virgins, Jesus speaks of the 10 virgins as being wise and foolish. They are to be prepared with oil. I am missing a page. And have their lamps burning. And this is a referred to in Matthew 26:27-29. And he took up the cup of wine and gave thanks to God for it. He gave it to them and said, each of you drink from it. Now in this scripture, he's referring to an ancient Galatian wedding. And because the Gentiles were Galatians, they knew what the wedding was and they knew what drinking from the cup meant. A Galatian wedding consists of the bridegroom leaving the father's home and going to get his bride. And we can refer to that as Jesus leaving earth, where God says, I gave my only begotten son, because God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. And so he sends Christ to earth. And they negotiate. When he gets to the bride's house, they negotiate with the father, the bride's dowry. And this is a correlation of Jesus paying the price with his blood. as the down payment, which is his blood on the cross, is considered to be the New Testament. This contract is our New Testament, and it declares that they are husband and wife. And with the Jewish wedding, the bride, the groom drinks of the cup and offers to the bride. If she accepts the cup, she accepts the covenant. If she doesn't drink of the cup, she refuses. Now, this is an example of when we're called to Christ. You can accept his invitation or you can refuse it. After that, gifts are exchanged. One of the gifts that we get from the groom is the gift of the Holy Spirit. And I'm not going to read that. And the gift from the bride is her faithfulness, her holiness, remaining righteous, because God is a jealous God. We are to put no one before him. After that, even though they're married, they separate. The groom goes back to his father's house and prepare a place for his bride. And that's where Jesus said, I go to prepare a place for you so that where I am, you will be also. It takes the bride goes and she purchases her material and she prepares herself. She clothes herself to be prepared for the groom when he comes. Because in a Galatian wedding, it does not take place until the father says go. He makes sure that the house is built according to the scriptures. He makes sure that the wedding feast is prepared. And so no one knows the time or the place except Christ. I mean, except God. And so after this is all done, this usually takes about a year, then God says, you may go and get your bride. And when he comes and get the bride, it's just like the scriptures say, the trumpet sounds. The trumpet is a symbol of an event getting ready to take place. It lets you know we are on our way. The bride is ready, and so are the bridesmaids. They're found sleeping, but they hear the trumpet and they awaken and they grab their lamps. Because most of the time when the groom comes for the bride, it takes place at night. And so therefore they have to have lamps to light the way so that they can see. The responsibility of the bridesmaid is to have their lamps ready to go. But in the parable, the bridesmaids are not really ready to go. And then they ask the wise virgins if they could share their oil. And they said no, because the oil represents true born-again Christians and the Holy Ghost. The Holy Spirit you cannot share with other people. You cannot give to other people. It's a personal relationship that you have with Christ. It is being prepared for his return. So you must be filled with this oil. When the door closes and the bride, the five unwise, did not make it in, it was because they lacked oil. The oil in the lamp matters more than the lamp itself. Without that oil, the lamp is basically useless. So, in referring in Matthew 7, 21 and 23, when that door was closed, it says, not everyone who calls out to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. Only those who actually do the will of my Father. So if you're not prepared and you get there, that door is closed, it is too late. You will not be allowed to enter. And another example of that is when in Genesis, where the door to the ark was closed. Once that door is closed, it can never be opened. It can never be opened. And this is just an example with him closing the door is when Jesus returns for his bride, it is that he's coming for his people. God always prepares to save his people before he pours out his wrath. And after that door is closed and his people are rescued, we all go to heaven. But after that door is closed, you can't. So you need to accept Jesus now. We need to be dressed with the oil at all times because the Spirit relives within us, as the songs they sang this morning. We need to be ready for service and keep our lamps burning, as it is in Luke 12 and 35, which says, be dressed for service and keep your lamps burning. We are to be ready at all times to serve the Lord, not just on Sunday mornings, but throughout the week. Although he is away preparing a place for us, we do not know when he will return. And we need to be prepared at all times. We need to be dressed with the fruit of the Spirit, as in Galatians 5, 22-23. Dressed as the bride was. We need to be holy. The Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit in our life. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness. These are the clothes that we need to put on to be ready for Christ. And again, just as in Genesis 8 and 16, when that the Lord closes the door, it's going to be too late. Now, you have to forgive me, I am missing a page, but I had just wanted to point out Brother Everett's message of last week. We have to trust God. And trusting God is not about just knowing of him. It's him knowing us. And so with the versions, when they said, Lord, Lord, did we not do all these things unto you? And he said, you know what? I do not know you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. And so the question here is, again, it's not about us knowing Christ. It's about Christ knowing you. Amen. It's not about the works and the deeds that we do. It's not about fulfilling the law as in the Old Testament. It's about trusting in God. It is about being filled with his anointing. It's about being filled with his Spirit. And all we have to do is just accept Christ into our life and be filled with his oil. Amen. And as Sister Misha spoke on, it's just that simple. It is just that simple. So getting back to our mission statement, to prepare the people of God like the five wise virgins for the return of Christ in Matthew 25 and 4. Here at the City of Refuge, our pastor, our leadership team are busy baptizing, teaching and preaching the doctrine of Christ, offering foundation classes, basic foundation classes. We offer group discussions. We have Emma's house. We have the cafe. We are preparing mankind for the return of Christ. So my message today is, we are the 67th book of the Bible. 2 Corinthians 3, 2 through 5 reads, the only letter of recommendation we need is you yourselves. Your lives are a letter written in our hearts. Everyone can read it and recognize our good works among you. We are living in a dark world, in the darkness spiritually. So our vessels need to be continually filled with oil. In Matthew 5, 14 and 16, it reads, you are the light of the world, like a city on a hilltop that cannot be hidden. And again, I say to you, that light is the oil within the vessel. Without the vessel, the oil, the lamp is of little use. And so we are to go and light the world, shine brightly before others, as in Matthew 5, 14 through 16, so that they will see our good works and give glory to our Father who is in heaven. So our works and our light shining, being filled with oil, is giving our good works so that the Father in heaven is glorified. And so really my message today, and not a sermon, is fill your vessel with oil so that we can go light the world. One more.
There is a candle in every soul, some brightly burning, some dark and cold. There is
Where's
a
the
who brings a fire, ignites a candle, and makes it all. So carry your candle, run to my darkness, seek out the hopeless, confused and torn. Hold out your candle for all to see. Take your candle, go light your world. Take your candle,
all my
go light your
all my scripture with the King James Version. She used the New Living Testament. That's what kept calling me off.
See how he's tried to light his own candle. Some other see now your sister, she's been robbed
of light too. We want to thank Mother Dean for that message. We want to thank Mother Dean for that message.
This morning, how many of y'all Before you get busy, you meditate and sit still before God. I had this thought this morning. It's like, as a ministry, we want to get out of that mindset of feeding people's physical needs and not their spiritual needs. Do you remember when Jesus had fed the 5,000, they followed him, and he came to him. He said, y'all are only following because I fed you. Y'all remember that? We're in a society that will follow Christ or even the church just because of what the church can do for them, but not necessarily because they want Christ. And we are living in a time, saints, where it's Christ has to be our ultimate goal. Because as she showed in that video, we could be here today, and it's not promised that we'll get to the benediction of this service before the rapture returns. Because the fig tree has budded. What do I even mean by that? The fig tree has budded. The nation of Israel has already become a nation. All of the prophetic that leads up to the rapture is happening. The blueprint for the temple for the nation of Israel to start making sacrifices again are already in place. A lot of that is going to start happening after the rapture. The rapture is imminent. We do not have time to be playing. And what I love about you as the church, you're the answer to sound the trumpet that will sound this morning. Do you know we live in a society that's okay with being deceptive? Lying, shacking, fornicating, stealing, no sense of kingdom purpose. The spirit of the Antichrist is so strong that it is even trying to blind so-called believers to think that it doesn't even matter. That's, you're going overboard with this Christian thing, this faith thing, this serving God thing. And so this kind of message today wakes us up and lets us know that we can't be playing with it. What a lot of us need, and I'm going to have a special class. That happened today. I want to start back. Barb, you remember when I taught that class on the Holy Spirit in Maryville? I want to teach a class because a lot of y'all just need the Holy Ghost. You just straight out need the Holy Ghost. As Minister Overby preached on Wednesday, because a lot of our wells are just clogged and needs to be unclogged, and the fresh eyes and purpose and vision, kingdom vision, needs to be released once again. And the joy and the vibrancy that comes along with that, you know, is so, so important. And so it's just so much. And it's all about the mission. Our mission is to prepare, amen, to be like the five wise virgins and to keep ourselves filled with oil and not allow the Philistines to clog our wells and keep a fresh flow of things going in our life. And so it's a good time. And if you're here today and you're not a believer of Jesus Christ, I would hate for the thought that you would leave here without knowing that Jesus Christ is your Savior. And so just for a brief moment, if you're here today with eyes closed, because this is just so totally personal, with everybody's eyes closed, if you pray with me, if you're here today and you have not accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and personal Savior, if you've not personally, not corporately, just by joining a church or being baptized, but actually saying, Lord Jesus, please come into my life and be my Savior. I want to do that now. I want to ask you, Jesus, to come into my life. If that's you here today, would you just raise your hand? We'll pray with you. You have not ever asked Jesus to come into your life to be your Lord and your personal Savior, so that when Christ do come for the church, you will be a part of that process. Because if you don't ask Christ to come into your life, you will not be a part of that process. And there's a great chance that you will not make it during the tribulation period. Is that you today? You might be here and say, well, I've accepted Jesus Christ into my life, but I haven't been living it. My wells are clogged. I've been like the five foolish virgins. I should have been doing things to display the fruit of the Spirit, but I've erred in my ways, and I just want prayer that for strength that I can do what God requires me and that I can be considered one of the five virgins. If that's you, would you just raise your hand? I'll pray with you. You've erred in your way. Could you come? I want to pray for you anyway because God want to bless you. I want somebody to hold her baby. And would you come, brother, those that you'd raise your hand, I want to anoint you with oil today. I ain't been working the whole month. I want to slap some oil.
As we tithe and give offerings, we are believing God for jobs and better jobs, raises and bonuses, benefits, sales and commissions, favorable settlements, estates and inheritances, interest and income, rebates and returns, checks in the mail, gifts and good surprises, finding money, bills paid off, bills decreased, blessing and increase. Thank you, Lord, for meeting all of my financial needs that I may have more than enough to give to the kingdom of God and promote the gospel of Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name, amen.